Oh. So we bless you, God. We lift up our hearts. We lift up our minds. We lift up our spirits before you, God. We glorify your name. For you are worthy to be praised. And so this morning, oh God, as we enter into your presence, we declare an open heaven over this house and over your people, oh God, over everyone that is joining us online. We pray, oh God, that your God will begin to speak, oh God, over the lives of your people in a way, oh God, that they would hear and that they would receive all that you have for them. So this morning we cast down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. We bring into captivity every thought and every plan of the evil one. We declare that this is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and we will be glad in it. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and strength. I will say of the Lord, He is my strong tower. My God, in Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver us from the snare of the fowler and from the voice of pestilence. He has been watches over Israel, gives His angels charge concerning us. And so this morning, O God, we walk, O God, in that word. We walk in that faith. We walk in the understanding, O God, that you are God and there is no one like you. So God, show up, O God, in your miraculous way. May there be healings. May there be deliverance. May there be breakthroughs in the lives of your people. May they experience you, O God. May they experience the grace and the power of God in a miraculous way. We bless you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. This morning, I just wanted us to just look at the book of Colossians, chapter 2, verse 17, and it says, "And these are shadow of things to come, but the body that casts it does not, the body that casts it belongs to Christ." Hebrews chapter 8, verse 5 says, "The place where they serve is a copy and a shadow of what is in heaven." This is why Moses was warned when he was about to build the tabernacle. "See to it that you make everything according to the pattern that was shown to you in the mountain." The Bible says that which Moses was building on the earth was a pattern of that which was already in the heavens. When we build in our lives, we have to build after the pattern that is in heaven, right? Then he goes on and he says, "For the law was only a shadow of good things to come, not the realities themselves. It can never, by the same sacrifices offered year after year, make a perfect those who draw near to him." So he was saying to us that the Old Testament was a pattern, was a shadow of things to come. The Old Testament is the purposes and the grace of God concealed. The New Testament is the grace and the power of God revealed. Amen. So we see that God is in the New Testament is revealing certain things. But he says the Old Testament was given for our learning and for our instruction. So that means there are things that when we read of accounts in the Old Testament, for example, and I shared this morning about Elisha and King Joash, as he tells him, okay, point the arrow into this, your bow into this area and shoot the arrow. Then he tells him, take the arrows and strike it on the ground. And he doesn't tell him how many times, and he strikes it 3 times, but he said to him, you should have struck it 5 or 6 times. And so when we look at those type of learnings, he's saying to us, there are things that you are desiring of God. But the more you press into God, the more you will see the answers of God. So there are things, scriptures that are read. So when the prophet gets angry with the king, it's a lesson for us to learn, is that how often, when God says us do something, we do it till God answers. Amen? That means he said to the king, if you struck it 5 or 6 times, you would have not just defeated him, the enemy, you would have completely wiped them out. That means they would not come and attack you again. There are some enemies that keep, there are some things in our lives, spiritual attacks that we experience every so often. But God is saying to you, if you obey my word, this enemy that you see today, you will see them no more. Amen. Then I'm here to say to you that in the lifespan of the Israelite nation, the Egyptians never attacked them again. The Philistines attacked them over and over again. But the Egyptians never, because God said to them, the enemy you see today, you will see them no more. Because if you come to that place where there's a complete trust, a place where there's learning. Now, a lot of us like to learn from experience. And some people say that experience is a good teacher. But I want to say to you and suggest to you today, learning from other people's experiences is a better teacher. You don't have to go through things for you to learn some lessons. Because someone else has gone through it, let that be a lesson for you. That's what the Bible says. The Old Testament is a shadow of things to come. It's a pattern. The Bible says there are some things that are common to men. There are some things that are common. You take your hand, if they did it 1,000 years ago, they put their hand in the fire, they got burned. You go today, you put your hand in the fire, you'll get burned. Some things that are common to men. Time may change. Technology may change, but there are some things that are common to men. I want you to know today, I pray that God will give you the ability not to want to learn from your own mistakes. And we should learn from our own mistakes. But the better way is to learn from the mistakes of others. Don't do what other people did. Because if we do what other people have done before, we will get the same results they got. We will get the same pain they got. We'll get the same hurt they got. Amen. May the Lord help you today. Amen. To learn. Amen. Some of you are saying, no. I want to learn. I want to learn for myself. No. Learning sometimes through experience is painful. Learning from experience sometimes can be hurt you. You may not be able to get up again. Amen. We're not as strong as our previous generation. A little bit weak now. Our grandparents, you know, we never saw them sneezing and coughing and getting sinuses. Tell us, what was that? They take Vicks, they rub it on you, they say, okay. We have to take chronic medication and do different, amen? We're not that strong, amen? They probably, if some of them, of our grandparents were alive, they'll come and laugh at us. Need to be tough enough. Amen. May the Lord help us to learn. Amen. And I pray that and then when you build it, this is what the Hebrews chapter 8 verse 5 says. We build after the patterns of that which is in the heavens. When you're building in your life, when you're building in your home, build after the patterns that is in heaven. Amen. Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. We are grateful for your hand upon us. We are grateful for your faithfulness and your grace upon our lives. And we pray today that even as we worship, as we praise you, as we glorify your name, that you will begin to move over our lives, that you will begin to speak into the lives of your people. That today we pray, O God, we build after the patterns of heaven. We understand that scripture has been given for our learning. And so today we learn from the experience that others have done and how you've given them breakthrough. Do it for us. This is our desire today, that we would encounter you in a special way. Bless us and minister to us in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen and amen, amen. God bless you. Welcome. And as you join with us, let's just worship God together, and then we'll get around the world. Amen.
Hallelujah. It's our Sunday morning celebration service. Amen. We are the King God, all the glory. We bless. I'm
Breakthrough when I dance, breakthrough.
situation happening right now, amen, that God is breaking forth on your behalf. We say, break through with my heart, break through with my mind, break through with my spirit, break through with my soul.
Come on, break right now.
Break your struggle.
Break through with my
struggle. You are the God. You are
when you worship.
Break through with my worship. Break through with my praise. Break through when I lift and glorify your name. Break through when I dance. Break through when I shout. You are the God. You are the God.
One more time.
Break through with my heart. Break through with my mind. Break through with my spirit. Break through with my soul. Break through with my weakness. Break through with my struggle. You are the God. You are the God. You turn it, Lord.
You turn it,
Lord. Oh, you turn it.
Today I want to encourage you that which the devil has meant for evil, God will turn around for good. The things that try to take you out, the things that try to distract you, the things that try to hinder you, the people, the places, the events, the enemy tried to orchestrate to take you out of the will and out of the plan of God. God is divinely moving on your behalf. God is divinely showing up on your behalf. That which could have killed you and that which could have taken you out of the plan of the Lord and caused you to be lost totally, the Lord had his hand on you, because he says that which the devil has meant for evil, I'm going to turn it around for your good. It was evil when his brothers chose to try and kill him and sell him off as a slave. But God used the opportunity of bringing him into Egypt and caused him to become a preserver of the life of the family. So today I pray God's grace is upon you. Everything that you've gone through, everything that you've experienced, every hardship, every hurt, every pain, every negative experience, God is showing up in your life. I pray today that may the Lord heal you. If healing is what you desire, may the Lord heal you. May the Lord give you a breakthrough. For some of you that are trusting God for a financial breakthrough, may the Lord show up on your behalf supernaturally. Supernaturally. May the Lord show up on your behalf supernaturally. I speak the hand and the favor of the Lord. I speak the grace of the Lord upon your life. That the Lord that watches over Israel neither slumbers nor sleeps. He knows your cry. He knows that midnight hour. He knows that moment in your life when it feels like everything is going astray. But today you are in this place just to hear the word from the Lord. That God has determined for you to be victorious. God has determined for you to become an overcomer. And you are more than an overcomer through Christ Jesus. So Father, this morning, won't you just bless your people? Won't you just minister to them? Even this morning as we sit around your word, we believe that the entrance of your word brings light and life. We pray over for your daughter, Pastor Margie, today, even as you would share the word of truth with us. I pray, O God, that may there just come the light of God. May there just come the grace of God. May there just come the power of God. Father, I pray that somebody's spirit will be ignited. I pray, O Lord, somebody, O God, like we would say, like Jeremiah said, it is like fire locked up within our bones. Father, it will be like, O God, that you're setting us on fire again for you. You are telling us, O God, that it is our time to stand up. It is our time to engage. It's our time to trust God for a victory. So today we declare that there's going to be a victory. There's going to be a victory. In and through the name of Jesus. We pray for our children, even as they go to Sunday school, bless them. Speak to them. them, Lord. Minister to them in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. 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 Bless the Lord. You may be seated. Amen. Thanks to the worship team. Over to Pastor Mark.
Army, and it says this, in this army an army of just 600 men that are going to face this army of the Philistines, who comes with 50,000 chariots, who comes with 6,000 horsemen, and who comes with troops that number like the sand on the seashore. They would have been annihilated in not even a minute, isn't it? Yeah. But there was something that this Philistine army knew about the nation of Israel, and they knew that the God that they served was great and was awesome. So there was something else that they had to do in order to overcome. That means that their troops, their chariots, their weapons was not going to be enough to overcome, right? And so we find when we look, let's just look into the chapter today. And in verse 17 it says, "And the raiders came out of the camp of the Philistines in three companies." Now these were just, when they talk about a raider, they talk about somebody that will come and will demolish. And not only will they demolish, but they will completely destroy and steal and kill. These were the men, that's the mentality of these men and this army that came towards them. And then it says that the one company was turned toward Ophrah, the land of Shur, and another company was turned towards Betharon, and another company towards the border that looks down the valley towards the wilderness. So they surrounded the Israelite army. And they knew that if they had to surround them, there was no way out. And then it goes on, and this is where I want to place emphasis on my sermon this morning. In verse 19 it says, "Now there was no blacksmith to be found throughout the land of Israel. For the Philistines said, lest the Hebrews make swords or spears." It says there was no blacksmith to be found throughout the land of Israel. And the Philistines said, lest there be, the Hebrews make themselves swords and spears. Now, you know, when we talk about a blacksmith, normally, you know, in the cowboy movies, you get the, when you look at, talk about a blacksmith, he's the one that makes the shoes for the horses, right? So the horses can go clumpity, clump, clumpity, clump, you know, like that. And they can run fast and not get hurt. So that's what we know a blacksmith to be. On the other hand, on the little joke, when you call somebody a blacksmith, it means they're a little bit, you know, dark in comparison to the rest of the other people, right? So, I don't know whether you're laughing or you're not laughing or you're smiling or not smiling, but I like to see it in your eyes, right? So, you know, we normally refer to that as a blacksmith. But here, these were the men, the blacksmiths were the men who made the swords or the spears. And now it says that there was no blacksmith found, because the Philistine army either captured them or killed them or removed them from where they were. Because they said, lest these blacksmiths make swords and spears for the Israelite army. Because if they have their weapons and they have behind them or going before them the Lord God of Israel, we will be defeated. And so Now, when I was preparing the sermon, I looked at what a blacksmith does and how he makes the sword. And it's so much of what you call similarities as to what the word does for us, as to how this blacksmith makes the sword. And the first thing that he does is that he has to prepare. So he takes this piece of iron, an ordinary piece of iron, and he has to prepare this piece of iron. But when he looks at this piece of iron, he just don't see the iron. He sees the finished product. Now you all know if you're a person that likes to make stuff and whatever, and if you look at something, immediately you know at the end, this is what I want it to look like. Because if you don't have a picture at the end, you're going to go all over the place, isn't it? The same thing with the word. When we're taking the word, there's a preparation for us. I want to know that as I start to study this word, what is going to be the end product for my life? And the end product must be that it must strengthen me, it must bring balance to my life, it must bring flexibility, it must bring it must make me hardened in the word of God, it must make me secure in who I am, it must change me, it must do all of these things. I must see how the word of God is going to, how effective it's going to be in my life. And then the other thing that he does in his preparation is that he has to have a forge. Now a forge is like a coal stove. It's like an oven, and he has to put the iron inside of there, and he has to work with that iron. So he has to have his iron, his materials. He has to have his end product in mind, and he has to have the heat, which is what we go through next. The second process is that the metal has to be put into the fire. It has to reach a certain temperature to make it workable. But not only to make it workable, it has to be cleansed of all the impurities. And for us as children of God, before we start to give the word to other people and tell them how effective it's going to be in their life or how it can work for them, it must work for us. It must cleanse us. It must remove the impurities from us. For the word to come out pure from where we are at, it has to work inside of us. That means there are things in our lives we need to get rid of in order to be an effective weapon. In order for the word to be effective in our lives, the impurities must be cleansed. And some of you may say, you know what, hey, I don't think, you know, this, not so much of things. I can work with it. I can, work around it. God is not asking us to work around it. We need to be pure and clean. The Bible says those that are pure in heart, they shall see God. Which means that God is saying not maybe you can be pure. He's saying yes, you can be pure. And so we need to come to that right place where we don't allow the impurities, the things of the world, the things that cloud our mind, that pull us away from the purposes of God. We say, Lord, I want to be pure. Let the fire cleanse. Let it cleanse me, Lord. Let it cleanse me. Then the third thing is the hammering. Now, you know, we don't like to hammering noise, right? We don't like, whenever anybody's doing any work or whatever, sometimes we put ear plugs or we tend to walk away, especially as ladies when the guys are doing work. We want to go away from wherever they are working, right? But the hammering is a shaping process. And it has to, the blacksmith takes this piece of iron, and after he's cleaned it, he puts it in the fire, he takes it out, he hammers it. He puts it in the fire, he takes it out, he hammers it. It's a painful process. If we have to look at our lives and the hammering that has to take place, the shaping, it's a painful process because there are things in our lives we are stuck to. And we say, you know what, this is how I am. I can't change. This is how I was born. it will not make any difference. It can be maybe like a tickle to somebody. Or maybe they might just make ow. But when we're using the word as a weapon, it must be able to annihilate. It must be able to speak. It may be the enemy, when it comes towards you with the words of discouragement, with words of, and it comes to bring you down and destroy you, we must be able in turn to destroy that enemy. That's how it needs to be. That's how strong the word of God must be in our lives. And then it comes to the hardening. Now, in the hardening process, it has to be cooled down, right? And the weapon has to be hard to prevent it from warping or breaking. Now, I was saying earlier, I said, you know what? You know, if you take the sword and if it's warped, and if you try, you know how you make, you know, when you wield your weapon, right? But if you need to have something that is so strong, it's hardened, and that when you strike with it, it makes a difference. When you strike with it, it makes impact. And that is how the word of God must be in our lives. It must be hardened in us. Which means that when I take it in, it must be set in me. I must not be able to forget it. It must not be something that is soft and, you know, it can just flow and flow out of my life. And you know, when like how if we have concrete, right, and you're setting concrete, you don't set the concrete all of you walk over it. You wait for it to set. And when it is set, it's very hard to break it. It takes a lot of effort to try and to crack that concrete and to break it and to destroy it. That's how the word of God must be in our lives. It must be hardened so that nothing can come against us. It must leave no room for there to be any break in our lives. Then the next thing is the tempering. The tempering gives the sword flexibility. It must be flexible, it must be durable. Which means that when we're using it must be effective, right? Then the next thing is the final grind. Now the final grind is not like the first grinding I was talking about. Because the first grinding was a harsh grinding, right? It was making a point. But the final grinding gives it a shine and a polish. It shines it, it polishes it, and it also, it makes it look attractive, but it also, the blacksmith also uses this final grind to make an engraving. Now when we look at the word of God in our lives, it must have a polished look. We as the children of God, if we are full of the word of God, there must be an attractiveness about us. There must be something that when people look at us, they must want what we have. They must want to know, how are you surviving in a world that is so full of turmoil? How are you surviving when there's no jobs, when there's no finances, when things are going haywire? How are you still prospering? How are you still getting promotion? How are things coming your way? That is how when they look at us, they need to see that there's something different about us. The word gives us a polished look, and what is engraved on in us is determined by what we want. Which means that I can say and engrave on my life, I am a warrior. I can engrave on my life that the Lord is my strength and my portion. I can engrave on my life there is nothing that is impossible with God. You can choose by what you're reading and what you're taking from the word of God, what makes you strong, what people can see through your life. Every one of us have a different message. Sometimes our messages may coincide, but we have a different message. And we are saying, Lord, I want the word of God to be engraved in me. As how we can say, I am as holy as unto the Lord. That should be what our declarations are. When people look at you, they must be able to see those kind of things. And so, this is when We got nice houses. We're living, we're eating nice food. The enemy is content. Don't worry. Yes, I will charge you for my services. But as long as you're not a threat to me, you can be comfortable. This is what the Philistines were saying. Because they knew that when the Israelite army was armed and ready for battle, God goes before them, those battles are won. And they are defeated. It does not matter how many chariots they have. It does not matter how many horsemen they have. It does not matter how many foot soldiers they have. But they know the moment the army of the Israelites are armed with swords and spears, and they come towards them, they're not coming on their own strength. They're not coming on their own ability. They're coming with the Lord of the hosts going before them. And that was the strength of the army. So the first thing said, as long as you are okay, you are comfortable, we are happy. So that is why they disarmed them. And today I want to encourage you. Don't be just happy with just being somebody that is content in this life. God didn't call us to be content. He called us to be soldiers in his army. And as soldiers in his army, we have to have weapons in our hand. We can't only have the defensive weapons, which is the helmet and the belt of truth and the breastplate of righteousness. We have to have the offensive weapons. Yes, we can ward off the weapons that are extended to us by the enemy. But we have to fight him off. And in order to fight him off, we have to have the word of God in our lives. That is why so many of us, when we go through trials and we go through struggles and we go through trying times in our lives, we don't know what to do. Because there's no word that is hardened inside of us that is we are able to speak. And we are able to fight. Some of us are fumbling. I don't know what to do. We need to draw our swords. You know that in those times when you are sick, and many of us, we know what it is like to be sick, where we can't get out of the bed. We know what it is to be sick when we're faced with some diseases and things like that we never expected in our lives. Some of us there are things that come our way, we cannot even explain it. But when sickness like that comes our way, we don't give up. We don't say, oh, I don't know what to do, I'll wait until my days and things like that. No, we take the word of God, which is our weapon of warfare. And we say to the enemy, you have no right over this body. For I am fearfully and I am wonderfully made. And so we fight off that sickness. We fight it off. We think, you know, if you just have to, just think, Lord, just give me something, Lord. Give me something from your word. And if you just have to remember, maybe you may not know exactly in the Bible where it is. But if you know the account of the woman with the issue of blood, how for 12 years she had this issue, the sickness in her body, and she was weakened. But she said, I heard of Jesus, and I know that he's passing my way. I'm not going to just sit here and do nothing. What did she do? She, in a weakened state, she was crawling on the ground in the dust. And she said, if only I can touch the hem of his garment, I'll be made whole. And we can do that. We may be in a very weak state, but we remember the word of God and say, God, if you can do it for that woman, you can do it for me. It brings remembrance to the word of God. How many of us are so beset by fear? In today's world, we know what fear is like. When this COVID pandemic hit our land and hit the world, we all of us went into a state of angels. How powerful is that? No matter what you're going through, you can stand up strong and say, I can come and I can overcome anything. When you feel like there's no way out, no escape, think about Paul and Silas in the prison. What did they do? They didn't cry. They didn't say, oh, I don't know what they're going to do. Weep and sit and lose all hope. They rose up in praise and worship before God. They were bound with chains. They were whipped. Their bodies were hurting. It's nothing like what we think about nowadays about being bound. It was a horrible experience, but they didn't let it get them down. They praised and they worshiped God. And we need to think about those kind of situations where we feel like we are bound in chains. Let every chain be broken by our worship and our praise. And you know those times when you dwell on your past, you know, when you look at the things that happened in the past, and it comes and it floods you, that's what the enemy does. Whenever you want to move forward, he takes you 10 steps back. Because he wants you to remember of the person that you were in the past, and he brings it to your remembrance and makes you feel guilty, and makes you feel less than yourself, and makes you lose all of your self-esteem, and makes you feel so down and out that you can't move forward. But the Bible says, forgetting those things which are behind. Imagine if we remember all of these scriptures while we're going through the situation. And it says, and I'm forgetting which is behind, and I'm straining forward, which means I'm just not looking. I'm looking intently, I'm straining my eyes because I want to see. You know how we do when we strain our eyes, right? Sometimes things are a little blurry. We have to screw up our eyes a little bit to get better focus. That's what he's saying. He's saying, forget those things. Strain your eyes. Look to what God has in store for you. Look towards the goal where you are going to win the prize. And all of us here today, we are just not any ordinary citizens on this earth. God has called us to be his sons and daughters. He's called us to be soldiers in the army. We are in a fight of our lives. I want all of you to realize that today. We are in the fight of our lives. Because all the enemy wants when he looks at you, he sees you as a formidable enemy. And he wants to destroy you. That's what he wants to do. But we're fighting with the weapon of the word. And that is why I want to impress in your hearts today of how important the word of God is. So we don't fluster. We don't get all weak. We don't all just look and say, I don't know which way to turn. I don't know where to go. Because we have the word of God that's hardened in us. It's in our spirit. It's in our mind. We remember it. And every time the word, every time a challenge comes up, every time, even if it's just for us to encourage somebody, we may not be going through the situation. But if we look at somebody else, we can't say, oh, I'm so dumbfounded, I don't know what to say. We cannot be dumbfounded. We always have to have a word in our mouths because we don't know who we will encounter. And no matter who you encounter, you just have to say, Lord, give me the wisdom. Give me, oh God, the word. Bring to remembrance, oh God, the word that maybe I heard on a Sunday service. And it's not enough for what you see on the screen. And to say, I've got my word for you. We have to day in and day out make a conscious effort to take the word of God and to read it and to memorize it and to put it into our spirit. Because that is the weapon of our warfare. Let's just bow into the word of prayer. Father, we thank you this morning. Thank you, O God, for your word. I pray today, Lord Jesus, for your people, those, O God, that are here, those, O God, that are watching online. I pray, O God, that we will come, O God, to that place where we realize that this word is